The scripture reading this morning is one sweet verse from Philippians 3:20. But our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ.
Good morning. Good morning. About 1984, for the very first time, I traveled abroad, and I had to go get a passport. Now, I'd been a citizen of the U.S. since birth because I was born to American citizens and I was born in the U.S., so I'd been a citizen, but all of a sudden I have this symbol of my citizenship. And so for the very first time, I made my trip abroad. I flew into Greece and they had to stamp my passport when I got into Greece. And then from Greece, I flew into Israel, and they stamped my passport in Israel. And then I flew into Egypt, or drove into Egypt, and they stamped my passport in Egypt. On the way back, interestingly enough, there had been a hijacking, and so they took my passport. Here I am in Egypt with no passport. Now, it made me a little nervous. I mean, can I get out of the country? What's going to happen? Etc. They finally gave the passport back after about 8 or 10 hours, and I got my passport again, and I was able to travel again. The next year, my oldest daughter and I made a trip to Vienna, Austria. So we fly into Austria, and I get my passport stamped in Austria. And from there, we go to Hungary and Switzerland and Germany and the Czech Republic and the Slovak Republic. And every time I go into another country, they would stamp my passport. You see, I'm an American citizen, and being an American citizen was something that was important. I would then, the next year, go to Romania, and I get a passport stamped in Romania. Interestingly enough, on that trip, one of my young men with me left his backpack with his passport laying in the park while he was playing with some of the kids there, and his passport was stolen. Oh, no. What are we going to do? And so we had to go through this whole process of getting him another passport so that we could get him out of the country again to come back to the U.S. I've made a lot more trips since then. I've gone to Great Britain, I've been to Turkey and to Jordan, I've been to the Netherlands, I've been to Saudi Arabia, and every time I get to go to one of those different countries, you kind of get a stamp in your passport. So I have lots of those old, I've collected all of the passports with all of those stamps. Being a citizen of the U.S. is a real privilege. I get to travel all of those places without getting special visas, although you do have to get visas to go to certain other countries. But I get to go to all those countries because I'm an American citizen. And citizenship is a big deal. Our text is one that really deals with being a citizen and what all of that means to be a citizen. After telling the Philippians that Paul had learned what really matters, he'd given up all of those things that were a part of his heritage, and he considered all of those as the manure pile, the garbage heap, in comparison to knowing Jesus and the power of his resurrection. After he's told them that and tried to emphasize to them that they need to understand that, he goes on to say that he hasn't arrived and he's not yet perfect or mature. Interestingly enough, that's interesting that Paul will say that about himself, because you think about him being this great apostle and he seems to have everything going for him. He says he's not yet attained, but he's pressing on to the goal. And that brings us to the text that we're looking at this morning. Beginning at verse 17, "Brethren, join in following my example and observe those who walk according to the pattern that you have in us." He begins by saying, "I want you to follow my pattern. Imitate me, imitate us, and I want you to watch in particular those who are striving to imitate us." Now, if you read Paul elsewhere, in 1 Corinthians, for example, he'll say that I am an imitator of Jesus, and you need to follow me because I'm imitating Jesus, so ideally you need to be imitating Jesus. You see, being a disciple means you follow your teacher, and in a very real way, you imitate your teacher, your master if you're a disciple, your teacher if you're a pupil. And so you're trying to imitate him and be like him. That's what being a disciple is all about. Being a disciple of Jesus means imitating him and being like him in every aspect of our lives. The call is for us to be Christ-like. And that's an important part of being a disciple. You see, I have this image of what Jesus is from the New Testament, and my goal is to be like Him, to live like Him, to appreciate what He appreciates, to understand what really matters. And I need to do that. It's at that point that Paul talks about those who are not imitators of Jesus. And so he makes this shift in verse 18. For many walk, of whom I've often told you, and now tell you even weeping, that they are enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their appetite, whose glory is in their shame, who set their minds on earthly things. He now says, you know, there are some folks who are not really imitators of Jesus. In fact, they're the exact opposite. They are folks who stand in opposition to the cross. You see, they don't appreciate what the cross is all about. They're enemies of the cross. They don't appreciate it. It doesn't govern their lives. It doesn't make a difference to them. That's the folks on the other side. They don't understand the all-sufficiency of the Christ, of the cross of Jesus and of Jesus' death on the cross and all of the difference that makes. They're not really children of God. Their end is ultimately going to be destruction. He describes them in three ways. First of all, their God is their belly. It's what they want that determines everything they do. It's their wishes. This is what I want. This is what makes me hungry. This is what matters to me, and I'm going to do what matters to me. They glory in the shame. Interestingly enough, the stuff they ought to be ashamed about, they almost boast about. To a large degree, these are folks who feel their superiority. They're boasting about who they are. They're boasting about their Jewishness. They're boasting about all of their background. And Paul has already said he doesn't do that anymore. He's long moved beyond that. He ends by saying, their mind is set on earthly things. They're sort of fixed with the stuff that's here and around them. That's what really matters to them. They are separated from God, and they don't appreciate that. It's at that point where he moves to talk about citizenship, the passage we read together just a few moments ago. Our citizenship is in heaven, from which we also eagerly await for a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform the body of our humble state into conformity with the body of His glory by the exertion of the power that He has even to subject all things to Himself. Our citizenship is really not American citizens. We're privileged to be American citizens. We have all kinds of special privileges that those around the world want. We have all of these folks who are trying to immigrate to the United States, some illegally, trying to get here because they see what we have and they want it. They don't have it back home and they want to get in here because they'd like to have some of the things that we enjoy. The freedom we have to worship. We just mentioned that as we were taking the Lord's Supper ago. David led us in that kind of thought. We are privileged folks to be able to do what we do here, to worship as we worship, to have the kind of privileges we have. The folks in Philippi, I think, understood this citizenship idea in a very real way. They're from Philippi, and interestingly enough, Philippi is deemed to be a colony of Rome. And if you're a citizen, if you're born in Philippi, you're automatically a citizen of Rome. Not just of Philippi, but of Rome. And so you have this wonderful privileges of citizenship, even though you're living in this colony. And in a very real way, Paul's going to play off of that word. That word citizenship is a word that can mean colony or homeland or commonwealth. But he's basically saying that those who are disciples of Jesus realize that this isn't home for them. Home for them is in heaven with the Father. It's being with Jesus. And I think we struggle with that whole idea. It's interesting how often we sing that song. We sang just a moment ago, Here We Are But Straying Pilgrims. Wonderful song. You see, I'm a pilgrim here, but my home is really in heaven, and what governs my life is what God in heaven would have me to do. Here we are but straying pilgrims. Or, this world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. Know that song as well? Or how about this one? I'm a pilgrim here within a foreign land. All of those are nice hymns that we sing And I wonder whether we really believe them when we sing them. You know, we're pretty well attached to being here. We appreciate what we have here so much that we may not really appreciate what's being offered to us by Christ Jesus. It's interesting that Paul is going to emphasize the fact that we are eagerly waiting for our Lord and Jesus Christ. We're eagerly waiting for Him to come back again. And so His return and His taking us to be with Him in heaven is what really matters, because we're disciples of Jesus. It's not here that matters most. It's not the stuff that I can get or accumulate here that matters most. It is my relationship with Jesus and what He's done for me and the difference He can make. And so there is this call. He's going to transform our bodies. You know, you got, the one you got here has all these aches and pains, and won't it be nice to be away from one with aches and pains? Things you can't eat and can't eat and all of those kind of things. Some folks are shaking their heads, yes, because they've been through all of this. And we're suffering through these kind of things, but on the other side, all of that's going to be gone. And we're going to be with the Lord, and our bodies are going to be transformed to be like Him. Our humble state, he says, will be in conformity with the body of His glory, His glorious resurrected body. And so we're going to be like Him. And He has the power to do that because He can subject all things to Himself. It's at that point that we move to chapter 4 and verse 1, which I think probably is a bad place to break the chapter. Because it says, therefore, because of what I've just said about this citizenship thing, my beloved brethren, whom I long to see, my brothers, brethren, and again, it's translated brethren by my New American Standard because they understood that he was talking about both brothers and sisters. My kinfolk, you are my kinfolk in Christ Jesus, and I long to see you. I want to get out of my house arrest in Rome and come back to Philippi and be with you folks, whom I long to see. You are my joy and my crown. Nothing makes him happier than to see that church at Philippi doing well. And that's true of preachers in general. We preachers are really thrilled when the churches we're working with are doing well and are blossoming and becoming what Christ would have us to be like and are accomplishing those kind of wonderful goals. That's our joy. And he says, you are also my crown. Now, it's not a crown that has jewels on it. It's a victor's crown. It's the kind of crown that they would put over the guy who wins the Olympic events. And that's a crown made out of really laurel. That's a kind of a bush that grows in Greece and has little white flowers on it. And you wind it around, you put it on the guy's head, and he's going to win that kind of crown. It's a victor's crown. In fact, I might even translate it to make sense to my audience. I long to see you, my joy and my gold medal. You know, I feel like I am a winner because of you folks. Because you've come to believe in Jesus because of what I taught you. And that makes all of the difference to me. And then he ends by telling them, in this way stand firm in the Lord, my beloved. Notice he ends up with my beloved, my loved ones, but he wants them to stand firm in the Lord. That's what it means. You see, I'm a citizen and I'm standing on my citizenship. It's my citizenship in heaven which makes all of the difference, and I'm going to stand firm in that. That's the call to be a disciple, to stand firm in this wonderful message of Jesus. And all that means to us. I think that's a wonderful text. And that whole idea of citizenship is one that we need to understand. Our citizenship, we are privileged to be American citizens. There are things that we get to do and privileges that we have and opportunities that we have because we are American citizens. But that's not the citizenship that matters. It doesn't make any difference whether you're a citizen of America or Romania or Israel or Egypt. Or what really matters is that you are a citizen of heaven. and your relationship with Jesus is the one that makes the difference. We're going to sing a song as an invitation song now, and it may well be that you need to take that important stand this morning, the kind of stand he tells him to stand firm in. You need to confess Jesus as Lord and be buried in baptism and become one of his. And we'd be happy to assist you in doing that. Perhaps there are others who have fallen away and need to come back to the Lord. If in any way you need to respond to that invitation, it is yours, and we'd bid you to do so as we stand and as we sing.